Correlograms, they are the second most important plot in time series analysis. So before we go into the correlograms, we need to understand what assumptions do we make with real data with time series analysis. The most important assumption, which is used to calculate the autocovariance function and the autocorrelation functions that we talked about in the last video, is that the dependence structure does not change over time. So what do we mean by that? We mean that, for example, if we have point x that is taken at time value of s and denoted xs, and a point xt which is taken at time point t, and the distance between them is tau or any specific like, and two other points, for example xm and xn, which are taken at two different points, but the distance between them or the lag between them or the tau is the same, then the covariance of xs and xt is equal to the covariance of xm and xn. So why are they equal? Because the covariance only depends on the lag. Of course, this is not 100% true, but this is an assumption that we make so we can progress with analyzing the time series. So again, it's a very important assumption. The assumption is that the dependent structure does not change over time. It's only affected by the lag. So the only factor that affects the covariance is the distance between the observations and not where the observations are. So for example, the distance between observation 1 and 5 is, let's say, 4 points in between. So the covariance of 1 and 5 and the covariance of 2 and 6 is going to be equal to the covariance of 3 and 7, because the distance between them are the same. So basically, to denote this, x of t and x of t plus tau is equal covariance for any tau points. So for example, if our gamma tau equals the covariance of xt comma xt plus tau, where tau can be 0, can be 1, can be 2. Of course, if it's 0, when t equals 0, it's going to be the covariance of xt comma xt, because tau is 0. And this is equal to the variance that we have seen in the last reminder that we showed in the last video. And this is, of course, equal to sigma squared, or denoted as sigma squared. So the correlation of xt and xt plus tau is equal to the covariance of xt and xt plus tau over the square root of variance of xt and variance of xt plus tau. We need to understand here that the variance of xt, which is equal to the covariance of xt and xt, and the variance of xt plus tau, which is the covariance of xt plus tau and the covariance of xt plus tau, is gonna be the same. So variance of xt and variance of xt plus tau is a single quantity that is equal to sigma squared, because we assume that the dependent structure does not change over time. So the variance of any point is equal to the variance of the other point. So this is going to be square root of sigma to the power of 4, because it's sigma squared times sigma squared. And taking the square root of that is going to be sigma squared, which is just gamma of 0. And the covariance over here is going to be denoted as gamma of tau. So basically, the correlation of any point with a certain lag is going to be gamma of tau over gamma of 0. Now, of course, we don't deal with the actual autocovariance and autocorrelation functions. As you know, in probability and statistics and in any data analytics, we usually deal with a sample. And it's very important to note the difference between the sample and the actual population of the data set. So the data set, for example, if we're measuring stock price, it's probably we have values from the 1850s until today. And within those values, we have a value for each hour of the day or each even second sometimes. But we're taking a sample of these values and we're working with them. And it's important to denote that there is a certain confidence of the values that we can infer from the sample that relates to the actual population. So what do we mean by that? We mean that if we're taking the autocovariance function of the sample that we have, it's going to be a simple calculation, which is 1 over n, then the sum of t equal 1 to the n minus tau, because it depends on the lags that we are trying to measure, of xt minus x bar times xt plus tau minus x bar. So it's very similar to the measurement of covariance, except that we are dealing with the sample, and hence we have the hat over here, because it's an estimation of the actual covariance that is done, that is inferred for the population. And the autocorrelation, which is denoted ACF, is going to be again the gamma of tau hat over the gamma zero hat. So how do we calculate those? Basically, what we need to know is that the correlation at point zero, or lag zero actually, so the correlation of any point where the lag is zero, so of any point and itself, is always one, because you're going to end up dividing gamma of zero hat over gamma of zero hat, and it's going to be equal to one. While for tau equal one, it's going to be gamma one hat over gamma zero hat. For two, it's going to be gamma two hat over gamma zero hat, and so on. So let's go over a small calculation example, just because the functions or the formulas seemed a little fuzzy. So this will help us understand them a little more. So basically, if we have a time series XT with 2, 4, 1, 3, 2, 4, 1, 3, 2, 4, these are the 10 observations or the sample that we are working with, and the number of observations is showing here, we need the value of the time series at lag 1. So we're basically just removing the first point because we are taking after the first lag. We need it at lag of 2, which is removing the first two points. And we need it at lag 3. This is to calculate the ACVF for the autocovariance function for 1, 2, and 3, and the autocorrelation function for lag 1, lag 2, lag 3. So the first thing in our calculation, we need to get the sample mean. And we do this by taking the sample of these 10 points. So if you sum all of them and divide by 10, you will get 2.6. And now, since we have the mean, we can go ahead and calculate the gamma zero hat, which is the autocovariance function for lag zero. And this is going to be the same that we have shown in the last slide. It's 1 over n, so 1 over 10, and the summation from 1 to 10 over all the points for xt minus x bar, which is the calculation of the variance of that point. So this is going to be 1.24. And now we have 1.24, so basically the autocorrelation or the rho zero hat is going to be gamma zero hat over gamma zero hat, 1.24 over 1.24, which is equal to 1. Now a little more complexity when we deal with the autocovariance function of lag 1. So basically we're taking the covariance between xt and xt plus 1. But of course we know that the xt values that we are dealing with and the xt plus 1, they need to be of the same length to calculate the covariance. So basically we are taking until n minus 1. So we're taking the first 9 values of xt to calculate the autocovariance with xt plus 1, which is of a length of 9. So we are doing the same calculation and we are getting the number minus 0.876. Of course, n is still the same, so we're dividing by 10. And the x bar is still the same because we are dealing with the x bar of the whole sample, which is 2.6. And now to calculate the rho 1, which is the autocorrelation of lag 1 within our sample, we're dividing the minus 0.876 over 1.24 and we're getting this value. The same when we deal with gamma 2 or lag 2 of the autocovariance function, the sample autocovariance function. We are taking the first 8 values this time because xt plus 2 is of length 8. And we're doing the calculation while summing from t equal 1 to n minus 2. So this is leading us to 0.608. Go ahead and try the calculations yourselves to make sure that you are comfortable with calculating the autocovariance and the autocorrelation functions. And when we calculate rho 2, we are getting rho 2 hat, of course, we are getting 0.49. The same we will do with autocovariance function of lag 3. This time we are taking the first 7 values of xt and calculating the autocovariance with xt plus 3, which is of length 7. So the calculation will lead to minus 0.728. And when we calculate the autocorrelation of lag 3, we are getting minus 0.587 by dividing the autocovariance of lag 3 over the autocovariance of lag 0. Now, what does this calculation help us do? This calculation is the basis or the values that we will have in our correlogram. So our correlogram, which is by its name, it somehow represents the autocorrelation of the time series. It is basically the autocorrelation function against the lag. So at lag zero, we all know that for any time series, the autocorrelation function at lag zero will be one. So we will always have a one at lag zero. And then for autocorrelation function at lag one, we have the value of minus 0.706 that we have showed in the previous slide, and the same 0.49 that we have calculated, and the same minus 0.587 that we have calculated. Of course, the calculations can continue for the length of the time series, but most importantly that we showed how it can be calculated. In a correlogram, you'll always have two kind of dashed lines or that shows the 95% confidence interval. So remember, why is confidence interval coming up here? Remember that we are working with a sample. So if our time series data, the actual population have, for example, 10,000 data points, we're probably working with a sample of 1,000, 2,000, or whatever number of observations in our sample. So we cannot infer 100% what is the autocorrelation or the autocovariance value is, but this gives us that at 95% confidence interval, I know that they are not equal to zero because they are exceeding this. So for example, the autocorrelation of two could be equal to zero, because within the 95% confidence interval, it can probably be equal to zero. So this value and this value should be ignored. However, the value, of course, at correlation autocorrelation function for 1 and for 0 cannot be ignored because they are very unlikely to appear in our population. So the assumption for these two lines is that the correlation is 0 between any two observations at that lag. But since we are exceeding it, for example, for 1, we know that it cannot be 0, and the hypothesis that the correlation between two points at lag 1 is 0 is rejected. Now, to do the same example with R, go ahead and try it. Basically, define your XT, your time series, and define it as a vector of 2, 4, 1, 3, 2, 4, 1, 3, 2, 4. And then just do ACF of XT. This should give you the autocorrelation function and the correlogram of XT. And as you can see, we have the value, of course, at 0, which is always 1, and the value at lag 1 beyond the 95% confidence interval, while all the other values could be arguably 0, because even though in our sample they're not 0, but we don't have enough confidence to say they are not 0 for the full population. If we want to know the actual values, we can call the object ACF from the actual correlogram object of ACF XT, and this will give us these values. And if you notice, these values, for at least for the 1, 2, and 3 lags, are exactly the same ones that we have calculated. So basically, at lag 0, it's 1. At lag 2, it's minus 0.7. At lag 3, it's 0.49. At lag 4, it's minus 0.587. And we know that the only value that is beyond our confidence interval is the lag 1. So we can confidently say that there is short-term correlation with our time series. So why is this important? Why is the correlogram important? Okay, it helps us understand the autocorrelation structure between the observations in our time series, but why is this important? Well, it is important because for a purely random time series, or a random process as we call it, ACF should be equal to zero for any value outside lag of zero. Of course, lag of zero will always be one because you're taking the correlation of a point with itself. But beyond that, it should be zero, or at least, of course, be within the confidence interval. So we cannot confidently say that it is not zero. If the correlogram presents a trend or seasonal variation, so for example, the one we showed is very simple, it's 2 points, but go ahead and try the ACF function with many time series data that you have, you will see that some of them show a trend, some of them show seasonal variation. So these need to be removed before we assess the short-term correlation. The trend and seasonal variation must be removed. So this gives us a hint that the correlogram tells us if the correlation, if the trend and seasonal variation have been removed completely or not. So basically, it helps us conclude whether a time series is stationary or not. Stationary, we will come to discuss what is stationarity in the next video, but stationarity is very critical to further analysis with the time series, specifically for the autoregressive and the moving average modeling of the time series, the AR and the MA. And with this, I thank you very much for watching. In this video, you learned how to develop a correlogram. Of course, you will not have to do it by hand, but now you understand how each value of the correlogram is calculated. In the next video, we will talk about how to utilize this correlogram to make some inference on the time series. And if you like the video, please subscribe to see more of this content and like the video. And I'd like to see your comments on how you feel about the time series analysis so far. Good luck with your analysis.